Ephesians 2 verse 8, for by grace you have been saved. Through what? Through what? Through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Verse 9 says, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Go back to verse 8. For by grace you have been saved, through faith. So we understand that even though we are saved by grace, without faith you cannot access that saving grace. Is that correct? Okay, now, technically, everybody on the face of the earth, the price for their salvation has been paid for. Is that true? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have an everlasting life. So, the price for everyone has been paid for. Romans chapter 5, even further, tells us that just as the sin of one man got every one of us into trouble, the same way the price one man paid has gotten everyone out of the trouble. But unfortunately, not everyone is experiencing it. So the grace of God, the Bible says the grace of God has appeared to all men. But you can only access that grace by what? Faith. So the distance between those who are going to hell and those who are going to heaven is just faith. Faith in the Lord Jesus. Faith in the Lord Jesus. You see how powerful faith is. The difference between you and those who are in hell right now is your faith in the Lord Jesus. That's the difference. You put your faith in Jesus. You trusted him for your salvation. That's the difference between you and hell. Now, without that faith, even though the grace is available, you can enjoy the grace though it's available. The key to unlocking it is your what? Your what? Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. So, grace is available. Saving grace. This one is talking about saving grace. Romans chapter 5 tells us about, all manner of grace. We have saving grace. You have grace for divine health, prosperity, and etc. But fundamentally, grace is assessed by what? Faith. So the reason some enjoy more grace than others is their level of faith. Grace is available to all. Whether it's saving grace, the reason you are saved and billions of people out there are not saved is faith. Not that you are more righteous than they are. You are not more righteous. In fact, there are many of them out there who are not saved, who are morally sound. If God was judging on the account of morality, many of them will be far ahead of us. I mean, some of us will still be on the queue trying to acquire salvation while they had acquired it or must have acquired it a long time. So despite their morality, they are not able to access the saving grace because of their unbelief or lack of faith. So grace for salvation is assessed by faith. Grace for prosperity is assessed by faith. A pastor friend of mine was sent me an SMS sometime last week, was asking me a question, but I didn't remember to answer. Today she repeated the same question. He said, Pastor Lawrence, please, in a nutshell, explain grace to me. And I said to her, really, grace is too big a word to explain via chatting. But I don't know where to start from, what to say. But in a nutshell, I told her that grace basically is God's unmerited favor. on a general note, but it has wide application of meaning. But bottom line is that grace is unmerited. We are now quoted Colossians chapter 1 verse 12. Giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. In a nutshell, this is what grace is. God qualified us. We couldn't qualify for it. We could never have been able to qualify for the inheritance. God saw our inadequacies, incapabilities, and He decided by Himself to make us qualified. So though we do not qualify by ourselves, but now we have become qualified because the one who determines or who judges everything has chosen to qualify us. The Bible says, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us, you and I, to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. In other words, we have inheritance of health, salvation, wealth, safety, protection, and, you know, name it, all kinds of inheritances. But we cannot qualify for it. No amount of your good works can earn you it. No amount of your fasting can earn you these inheritances. And God, looking at your inadequacies, knowing that in 1,000 years you cannot work to earn it, now decided, you know what? Let me just make it easy for you. I now declare you qualified. I now make qualification for you accessible. But you see, now, even though He has given us the qualification with His grace, but the key to the entrance is faith. Are you listening? The key to accessing it is faith. So this is grace. So I try to explain to the pastor from this perspective that this is what really grace is about. In a nutshell, but has wide application, more like trying to summarize a 250-page book into a few sentences. So let's go back to Ephesians 2:8. Hallelujah. So by grace you have been saved. You didn't earn it. You didn't labor for it. You couldn't have earned it. You couldn't have qualified for it. So God says, you know what? I'll give it to you. I'll give it to you. It's all yours. It's all yours. It's all yours. The only thing I need from you is faith. Just show up with your faith, and it will be delivered into your hand. It's all yours. Now, while some are struggling for it, trying to earn it, laboring tediously, trying to enter it, but God is saying, for those of them who didn't need to struggle, but they put their trust in me, I've given them access to it. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. He said, being justified by faith, Romans chapter 5. Being justified. Justified means just as if you never sinned. In a nutshell. To be justified means to be declared righteous. In other words, technically you are guilty of everything. But God comes and looks at you, lays hands on you, say, you are justified. You are declared righteous. There's a member of this church who experienced pure, typical grace, justification by grace. He killed someone. Now, I'm not in the dream. Reality. He stabbed somebody to death. And then he was picked up, sent to Kirikiri. And, you know, he wasn't charged for manslaughter, he was charged for murder. And really, the judgment for murder is death. Death by hanging. Praise God. So that was what he was waiting for. And then, finally, the last day of appearing in court, he comes to court. After all said and done, the judge said, you are discharged and acquitted. Amazing grace. It was few days after he left Kirikiri that I stumbled into him. He shared his story with me. So I've known him. Where have you been? And he told me his story. And then I led him to Christ. That's grace. Not that somebody pleaded for him. He was an abandoned project by family. I mean, that's justification. So the judge declared him justified. You can go. There's no case against you. You can go. Now, the people who caught him killing were policemen. He said he had just finished stabbing the guy. The guy was bleeding to death. He didn't know that policemen were around, and then suddenly they rounded him up. Praise God. And then somebody else comes and says, who has the authority? I release you. You are justified. That's what happened to us. We are condemned. But God justified us. But that justification, even though it's available to all, you can't access it except through the master key of what? That's why we say faith is the master key. Prayer couldn't have been the master key. Like we have been told over time. Prayer could not have been the master key. Because how many years are you going to pray to earn salvation? How many years are you going to labor in prayer? How many of you got saved after laboring in prayer? You labor and you give birth to salvation. How many of you? If I see any hand up, I'll be afraid of you. None. Praise God. But we are saved, justified by faith. Grace has been available all these years. The day you got saved was not the day grace was made available to you. But the day you got saved was the day you used the key of faith to unlock the grace. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. And that's how it is in every day. The day you receive your healing is not the day the grace of healing is made available. But that's just the day your eyes open and you pick the key. You unlocked it and then healing came. Before then, the issue had troubled you, tormented you all these years. But the grace that provides for it was available. But despite the availability, you could not access it until you pulled out the key of what? The key of what? The key of faith. So we have been justified by faith. And then we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. But justification is by what? Faith. Next verse tells us that not of works, lest anyone should boast. You cannot boast about it. Why? Because it's by what? Praise the name of Jesus. All right, let's go back to Romans chapter 4. Now, I laid that foundation to let us know that, first of all, even our coming into the kingdom was on the account of faith. Faith started it, faith will finish it. Faith started it, faith, only faith will finish it. You cannot receive by works what you started with by faith. Okay, before Romans 4, give me Romans 5. Therefore, having been justified, again, where we read earlier on was Ephesians. This is Romans. Having been justified by what? By prayer. By warfare. Warfare. Huh? By what? By faith. By faith. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Having been justified by faith. I said something the other day. That guilt destroys faith. It weakens it. Makes faith very difficult. Practically impossible. You want to exercise faith, the enemy brings the picture to even you. So what you are saying, you are trying to say in the name is even you. Amen. Why? Ignorance. Having been justified by what? Faith. Your justification is by faith. So when you stand before God, God looks at you. He sees you exactly the same way He sees Jesus. Spotless, guiltless. That's why the scripture says there is now therefore. Huh? Are you sure you understand what he's saying? What does it mean that there is now therefore no condemnation? Huh? Huh? You're justified. Any other? Not guilty. No condemnation. That's more like the judge looking at that murderer, that former murderer, and said, there's no condemnation. You can go. How? On the account of faith. The day Paul preached, remember, faith comes by what? So as Paul preached. Faith came. When faith came, it entered the heart of the man. The man took faith. Paul saw that the man had taken hold of faith, and he had the faith required to enter into the grace of healing. Paul told him, get up. More like, you already got it. Get up. Get up. And he got up and he received it. That healing is already around you. It's actually already in you, because it's part of the full package. But the day faith finally sinks into the center of your heart, you would not need anybody like Paul to tell you get up. You would just know it's done. It's done. Let the whole world stand and tell you it's not done. You would not bother arguing with them. You know that you know. It's more like somebody coming to tell you, hey, your name is not Abai Sunday. And then you begin to argue. That means there's a problem. But when the whole world tells you your name is not Abai Sunday, you laugh, you ignore them like, actually, everybody has gone mad except me. Why? Because you know that you know that you know that it's yours. You have it. It's yours. It is done. Glory to Jesus. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. Is there any symptoms in your body right now? Is there any need in your body, in your system right now? Is there anything that is inconsistent with the divine health that grace has provided for you? As you listen to the word tonight, faith is set up in your heart. All you need to do is just to unlock it. Unlock it. Now, here we see riches in abundance. Abraham, to start with, manifested it. Is that true? Everything Abraham did brought money. Somebody didn't hear what I said. Everything he did brought money. Even when he made mistake, he brought money. Holy Spirit. Let me tell you, you may have made mistake, and because of that, you dropped your guard, the enemy robbed you. Restoration is coming sevenfold in the name of Jesus Christ. In this kingdom, we don't lose. I've always said it. We don't lose in this kingdom. I lose nothing. Because regardless of what goes, it comes back. It comes back bigger and better and brighter. It's a mindset. So that's why when you enter into that place, you have entered into what the Bible calls rest. So when others are fretting, you are calm. They don't understand your secret. Because then you know that you lose nothing. When Abraham got to, I forgot the name of that town, and then they took his wife, he didn't fret, he didn't pray. Did you ever hear that Abraham prayed? Huh? Did you ever hear that Abraham prayed? He travailed. Huh? Talk to me. Abraham travailed. They took his wife and he went to intercession. Oh God. Oh God. You know she's my only wife. Oh God. Do something new in... Abraham didn't go into all that. Why? Oh Holy Spirit. He already had a covenant with God. And covenant, I've described it some time ago. Covenant is an agreement between two parties. And in that agreement, the part of that agreement is, whatever is yours is mine, whatever is mine is yours. Whatever happens to you happens to me, whatever happens to me happens to you. I will defend you with my life, with my blood. That's the essence of blood covenant. So when Abraham's wife was taken, it was like God's wife was taken. So God came and told the man, you are a dead man. The man said, for what? He said, the woman in your palace is another man's wife. In fact, he's a prophet's wife. The man said, but God, he told me his sister. He said, that's why you are not dead. That's actually the reason you are not dead. Now release that woman now. But don't release her like that. Release her with gifts. Because that man is not happy with you. Send gifts. But God, he lied. Shut up. Send gifts. Send gifts. And then the man gathered gold, silver, cattle, everything. Gift. Abraham became rich, even in his mistakes. I hear. If you know who you are, you will never worry one day. Doesn't matter what happens. When Jesus said, do not worry, he meant what he said. He understood that there will be circumstances around you. There is nothing you are going through right now that he didn't foresee, and yet he said, do not worry. In other words, I have seen everything you will ever go through. There is none of them, even all of them combined together, that is worth your worry. Why? I've got you covered. I've got you covered. So, let's get back here. The famous promise God gave Abraham that he and his children. Who are those children? Give me Galatians chapter 3. Because when we say we are the children of Abraham, many of us think that, you know, we are just trying to encourage people. Galatians chapter 3, give me verse 7 to start with. Verse 7, we just rush through into verse 20-something. Galatians 3, verse 7. Therefore, know that only those who are of faith are sons of Abraham. Who are those of faith? Give me Message translation. Is it not obvious to you that persons who put their trust in Christ, not persons who put their trust in the law, are like Abraham, children of faith? Give me NIV. Understand then that those who believe are children of Abraham. Who are those who believe? Therefore, who are the children of Abraham? Do you believe? Do you believe? Which side are you? We are the children of Abraham. Give me verse 29 quickly. Alright. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Do you belong to Christ? Whose seed are you? Whose seed are you? So when the Bible talks about the children of Abraham, who is it talking about? Do you believe it? Do you really believe it? Can God lie? We own the world. Are you listening? We own the world. Now let's get back to Romans chapter 4, verse 13. That famous promise God gave Abraham that he and his children, who are the children, would possess the earth. You are possessors of the earth. Oh, I want people of faith here tonight. I said you are possessors of the earth. You are possessors of the earth. You will buy up shopping malls. In the name of Jesus Christ. You buy up warehouses. In the name of Jesus Christ. He said that he and his children will possess the earth. He said the promise was not given because of something Abraham did or will do. And in order to prove that, God allowed Genesis chapter 20 to happen, where Abraham's wife was seized because he lied. But in return, God gave him back his wife and then gave him inheritance on that account. So that inheritance was not on the account of what he did or will do. He didn't earn it. He didn't qualify nor deserve it. Alright? It was based on God's decision to put everything together for him. God is putting everything together for you. I said, God is putting everything together for you. In your job, he's putting everything together. In your relationship, he's putting everything together. In the name of Jesus Christ. In your career, he's putting everything together. In the name of Jesus. Glory to Jesus. You don't have to struggle for everything. Break away from the mentality of struggle. You struggle to get a job. After struggling to get a job, you struggle to rise. While you are still struggling to rise, struggle to marry. After struggling to marry, struggle to stay married. That cycle is shattered. That cycle is broken. In the name of Jesus Christ. Okay. The Bible says that it was based on God's decision to put everything together for him, which Abraham then entered when he believed. So Abraham had a part to play. What was Abraham's part? What's your part? What's your part? Some people think that their part is to struggle. You know, the more you struggle, just keep on struggling. One day God will just, out of pity, in fact, God will be moved to tears and then decide to bless you. That's mentality of religion. The Bible says God put everything together for Abraham. And then Abraham now entered into it by believing. Hallelujah. Anything you believe is what works for you. Anything you believe. Anything you believe is what works for you. Now, sometimes your belief will be challenged. That's why some people miss it. It is in the area of the fight of faith that a lot of Christians miss it. They don't understand what the fight of faith is. I don't want to be tempted to go into it tonight. But that's the critical point where a lot of Christians miss it and give up on their faith. But if you understand how to fight the fight of faith, you actually know that it may look difficult, but it's actually easy. And when you win that fight of faith, you step up. You enter the next realm. You enter the next realm of your inheritance. You win at that fight of faith at that level again. You enter the next realm again of your inheritance. So, now, when you say there is a fight, it means that there is something is trying to oppose you. Am I correct? Yes. The only fight God has called us to fight is the fight of faith. Paul said, fight a good fight of faith. In a nutshell, we're going to treat it elaborately down. In a nutshell, what does it mean to fight the fight of faith? To stand your ground. So the enemy is coming with contradictions and oppositions. It's coming with lying vanities. The Bible already warns us, don't observe lying vanities. It's coming with things that threatens, that looks, you know, like it negates what you believe. That questions your belief. You stand your ground. Practical example. I've told you many times about a story of, you know, when my wife and I were cutting, and then one night we are at the Tiroko bus stop around 12 midnight and 1 a.m. And then some armed robbers just emerged from, you know, the dark. And then my friend disappeared, you know, he took a flight. Listen, when you are running for your life, it's different kind of run. It's a different kind of run. I mean, you don't observe any pain, whether there's pain there before. You see, that pain dies instantly. The guy is sprinting. And then, I was going to show him that I was much more healthier. I took the first, second step, but I remember. So I came back, put my wife behind, and I took a stand. I stood my ground. The guy was coming with a knife, but I stood my ground. I didn't move one inch. I stood my ground. Technically, as he approached me, what was I supposed to do? Huh? Talk to me. Huh? To fidget and run. That's the point where Christians lose the battle. When they see the danger or the opposition of their faith, maybe in their finances, in their health or whatever, they panic. And then once they panic, what they have already grabbed hold of, already in the spirit, once they give it up, the enemy smiles, the enemy picks it up. But if you stand your ground, just like I did, even if the enemy is coming close, and the closer it comes, the more the picture that is painted, but you refuse to observe those pictures, he will come close enough to look at your eyes and realize that this guy means business. What does he do? He will turn back. And once he turns back, forget it. That's the point of manifestation. That's the point where that healing manifests. The point where that job manifests. The point where that relationship manifests. The point where that business manifests. Why? You stood your ground. You refused to quit. You refused to say anything contradictory. You refused to utter contradictory words. Or to permit contradictory thoughts. Or to act in a contradictory way. Hallelujah. So Abraham entered into what God put together for. There's so many things God has put together for you. In this season you are entering into it. In the name of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ. Listen. What you have lost, you will not remember it again. Because you will be giving much more than that out regularly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There are some of you, God has given you pictures of businesses, but you've been afraid to enter it. What God has already prepared for you, but you are afraid to enter it. Why? Because you are not sure. You are not convinced. You are not certain. What if? There is no what if in faith. No. There is no what if. There is no what if. There is nothing like what if in the realm of faith. Because there is only one way. There is no what if. Don't create opportunities for what if. When the enemy brings about the what if, tell him there is nothing if. There can be nothing if. Because God cannot lie.
We hope you enjoyed this audio clip by Pastor Lawrence Onoche, the senior pastor of the King's Heritage. For any inquiries, please call 081-872-70372. Please feel free to share. God bless you.